Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 3463 in the name of Fergus Ewing on the future of funding for rural development. Can I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now? I call on Fergus Ewing to speak and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, 13 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The devolution of most rural powers in 1999, together with access to billions of pounds worth of funding through EU membership, gave Scotland's Parliament and Government key tools with which to support our rural and coastal communities. The now clear intention of the UK Government to take Scotland and all of the UK out of the EU and out of the single market means, Presiding Officer, that rural Scotland does face a very uncertain future. So I want to set out in today's debate what Scotland should rightly expect from the UK Government and to seek cross-party support and agreement from Parliament how to best protect Scotland's rural interests. Myself and my advisers, have had fruitful discussions with other parties, and I'm pleased to say, Presiding Officer, that these fruitful discussions have enabled us to be in a position to support this afternoon, later this afternoon, both the Labour and the Liberal Democrat amendments. And let me say at the opening of this, the very first rural debate of the new year, that I shall seek to work with people in other parties in this chamber on the key matters that we face. That, Presiding Officer, is my new year resolution. We shall see.
Now, we all heard it, we'll hold you to it.
I'm sure you will, Presiding Officer, and rightly so. So we will see how it goes. But I hope too, Presiding Officer, we can also agree on this fundamental point that devolution has been good for rural Scotland. It has enabled this Parliament and successive devolved administrations to focus our time and our energy on key rural issues. And all these issues have benefited from having control over policy and legislation underpinned by public funding within the context of a wider EU framework. Indeed, much of the development undertaken in rural Scotland in the last 18 years has only been possible through EU funding support, around 4.6 billion euros on the Common Agricultural Policy between 2014 and 2020 alone. At the same time, EU membership has enabled us to protect our precious natural environment and contribute to our climate change ambitions. Now we are losing that with nothing in its place. No guarantee of funding beyond Brexit. Simply a promise of policy to come and a plea for trust to deliver a better, brighter deal for rural Scotland. The fact that there is no plan for Brexit is no excuse for there being no plan on what will be done to replace EU funding and CAP, including the Scottish Rural Development Programme and the European Maritime Funding Programme. Presiding Officer, today Michael Russell is representing this government at the Joint Ministerial Committee on UK Negotiations, and next week I and Rosanna Cunningham will meet with counterparts from all the UK administrations to discuss rural and environmental matters. These discussions are essential as we negotiate the difficult months and years ahead. We have been promised treatment as equal partners, and we will hold the UK government to that promise and enter into all discussions about the future for rural Scotland in good faith. But we can be forgiven to also adopting a degree of scepticism if we consider the actions of this UK government, or rather its inaction on commitments made on rural funding, in particular in relation to the CAP funding review. Now, so far, DEFRA has failed to carry out the full review of the UK allocation of agriculture funding. Yet, George Eustace, with whom I have a workmanlike relationship, Presiding Officer, George Eustace promised such a review would be concluded by the end of last year. Yet, the review has not even begun, far less be concluded. If CAP is to end, why is a review needed? Well, one very good reason is that it will highlight the stark difference in payment rates per hectare between Scottish farmers and farmers in the rest of the UK. For example, English moorland farmers receive around €65 per hectare, whereas Scotland's poorer settlement means our moorland Region 3 farmers only receive around €10 per hectare. And even on better quality land, English farmers receive around almost €30 per hectare more than Scottish farmers. So at present, there is no level playing field north and south of the border. I hope we would all agree that livestock and arable farmers doing the same job in different parts of the UK should receive comparable levels of payment within devolved systems. But English, Welsh and Northern Ireland farmers receive payments that Scottish farmers can only dream of. And this is not the only example of the UK government treating Scotland unfairly. I do remain dissatisfied with the current constitutional arrangements pertaining to sea fish, following the UK government's refusal to include the power to raise a Scottish seafood levy in the Scotland Bill. To me, repatriation of the near £2 million sea fish levy raised here in Scotland makes perfect sense. The UK government's inflexibility in this matter is all the more surprising when you consider, Presiding Officer, the devolved nature of fisheries policy and the parallels between the sea fish levy and the red meat levy are striking. Once again, Scotland's legitimate request for greater influence on how money paid by Scottish farmers is utilised to promote their interests has until recently been rebutted by the UK government. Now, while some progress has been made on these levies in the short term, and I have sought to encourage good relations with UK counterpart ministers, Presiding Officer, none of these examples augurs well for our future relationship on funding, should the UK government seek to take over that from the EU upon Brexit. So aside from the unanswered question, will the UK match EU funding post-Brexit, there are key unresolved issues between the Scottish and the UK government where Scotland's rural fishing and farming communities are, we believe, not getting a fair deal. At a farming conference in the new year, Andrea Leadsom appeared to suggest that funding for rural development should be fundamentally changed. The UK government has guaranteed the continuation of direct payments in farming until 2020 and structural fund payments, which includes farming, fisheries, forestry, rural development and environmental funding up to the point of an EU exit. Now, this, so far as it goes, is welcome, but there are outstanding issues that must be addressed. Support for less favoured areas is crucial for Scotland, with 85% of our farming land classed as less favoured compared to only 15% in England. But the UK government is yet to guarantee this funding for applications in 2019, Presiding Officer, let alone beyond that year. Presiding Officer, EU funding is vital for the continued viability of the sustainability of Scotland's rural economy and communities. Beyond Brexit, UK ministers are signalling a major shift in how such funding might be determined and allocated in future. And they're also suggesting that there might be a UK-wide scheme with the UK government apparently in charge. Yet we have cause to be wary of such an approach when we are still asking the UK government for the full £190 million of CAP convergence monies, which UK ministers top-sliced for their own purposes, money which is rightly Scotland's to support our farmers and our crofters. Presiding Officer, surely there should be repatriation with power over policy and funding, and indeed the monies themselves, transferring directly to Scotland and not passing through Westminster. On this, we agree with the Labour amendment in terms of repatriation of powers. In the document, Scotland's Place in Europe, we have made very clear our position and powers. These should be repatriated from Europe to Scotland. Powers on rural policy, which are still reserved, should be transferred where additional powers are required to enable us to support our rural economy more fully. For example, on immigration, these should also be devolved. Moreover, discussions on powers over policy should be based on mutual respect for the current constitutional settlement on these islands. It is, Presiding Officer, hard to see any evidence of that respect when we only learn of UK ministers' intentions, courtesy of a question and answer session at a conference. Yet there is a strong case for stability and certainty in the short term, at least. Rural Scotland now faces three different but very serious threats. First, loss of labour through the UK view on immigration. Second, loss of access to the EU single market. Third, loss of financial support. And let me take one specific example of this, Presiding Officer, the humble Scottish tatty. Currently, EU funding not only supports the production of the potato on farms all over Scotland that end up in our plates, but also funding also supports crucial research and development into seed potatoes. That has enabled Scotland to become a world-leading producer of seed potatoes, exporting our knowledge, expertise, and, of course, tatties to other EU states and, indeed, beyond. Currently, we pay no tariffs for such exports. Further, our application of EU regulations guarantee the provenance of our seed potatoes, enabling their export internationally. Indeed, potato producers to whom I've spoken see that these regulations, far from being red tape, are actually proof of quality and compliance, and that these regulations are actually necessary to maintain access to these vital export markets. Yes, I certainly will.
Stuart Stevenson.
Is a very important issue for my constituents. Is the Cabinet Secretary aware that some of the more northern states in the United States, such as Idaho, which have similar climatic advantages in growing seed potatoes, are poised to exploit any lacuna in our ability to be able to supply seed potatoes to export markets, and that the danger is not simply local, but global?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I've always found that one of the distinct advantages of taking an intervention from Mr. Stuart Stevenson is that it tends to be an educative process. And this is no exception, because I think he makes a point of which I'm unaware, but is a very salient point indeed. It is to point that there are many growers of potatoes and other produce ready to step into the breach, and in a world where there's tariffs in future, then, of course, they will see the commercial opportunity so to do. There's a very clear commercial opportunity. And all over the world, those growers of various types of produce, including potatoes, will see an advantage for them. Of course they will. And they can't be blamed for that. And therefore, that's an extremely important point. And it is illustrative, I think, of one, of just one of the several serious risks. And I've not deliberately in this debate, Presiding Officer, sought to express all of this in hyperbolic, ultra-rhetorical terms, but simply set out the facts in a calm, reasoned manner. So, going back to the humble tatty in the remaining time, at every stage of the process, there are people employed and engaged in growing, harvesting, storing, researching, developing, transporting, selling, preparing, trading our potatoes. Many of them are Scottish, but many of them are for the EU, and we want them to be able to stay here and continue to give of the work of this country. I'll move fast forward to a conclusion, Presiding Officer. I'm very much looking forward to this debate. I hope it will be shed more light than cast heat. And the priority for all of us is clear, to do all we can to protect rural Scotland's interests in these times of uncertainty. And I can reassure you and all members that I will continue to work tirelessly towards these objectives. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you. I never thought I'd hear lacuna and potato in the same sentence, but I have today. I call Peter Chapman to speak to and move Amendment 3463.3. Mr. Chapman, please, 8 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I refer members to my register of interest. And I also welcome the new cuddly Mr. Ewing. We have just heard the Cabinet Secretary's concerns over the future of rural development in the years to come. But it's unfortunately typical of this SNP government to respond to everything the UK government does as another sign of impending doom for Scotland. It is, I have to say, incredibly disappointing that Fergus Ewing cannot, and will not recognise the opportunities that we have before us. There is a huge prize to be won for Scottish and UK agriculture in the ability to design our own system, one that caters specifically for our farming sector. We need a policy that is simpler and easier to access. We need a policy that delivers support to these farmers who are producing our food and not supporting slipper farmers. And we need a policy that drives innovation, the uptake of new technology, and delivers an efficient and profitable industry that respects and enhances our environment and has high animal welfare standards at its heart. Now, for the last 20 years of the CAP, each review has seen a reduction in the pot of money available for farmers and an increase in complicated red tape and bureaucracy. And the Minister cannot look at that information and seriously expect that it would have been any different going forward. Across Europe, budgets are under pressure, and with CAP being the largest spending item on the EU's balance sheet, it was never realistic for cap spending to be maintained when southern European economies are struggling so much. Fortunately, going forward, the UK economy looks in much better shape to deliver the support agriculture needs. And we need to argue strongly, with one voice, that agriculture receives roughly the same level of support after 2020 as it is receiving now. The future prosperity of agriculture demands nothing less.
Will the member take an intervention?
Yep.
Stuart Stevenson.
The member will, I'm sure, be aware that Scotland gets 16.4% of the support in the UK that is given to agriculture. Is he arguing for that proportion of support to Scotland to be maintained, or indeed, perhaps because of the lower acreage payments that there are in Scotland, increased as a proportion of UK agriculture support?
Mr. Chapman.
I'm basically saying, as I said, that we must argue for roughly the same amount of support as we've been used to in the past. So it is time for the SNP to accept that we won't be members of the EU after 2019 and to start planning for the future after Brexit. And starting that process will require a clear set of objectives. It will need guiding principles that inform the policy throughout. Now, there are serious concerns about the ageing population of farmers, for instance, a definite sign that more needs to be done to encourage new entrants. That is why I am so angry at the lack of funding for the Young Farmers Startup Scheme. I know that over £5 million out of a pot of £6 million has been spent in year one, and that recognises how important this fund is. And this scheme should be operating throughout the SRDP period 2014 to 2020. But how can it, when most of the money has already been spent? So I therefore urge Fergus Ewing to allocate additional money to this scheme to help new farmers into business. And it is also vitally important that new entrants gain access to all support payments from day one of their starting to farm. You know, sadly, this does not happen now, and it's a great disadvantage to young folks starting. The objective for Scottish ministers should be clear, a system built to work specifically for our agricultural industry. Of course, the last thing that anyone in rural Scotland wants is totally different systems on each side of the Tweed. That would distort competition too much. There needs to be a UK framework, but a framework that allows for unique Scottish interests to be catered for without creating, in NFUS's words, significantly divergent agricultural policies across the UK. That is why my colleagues and I are today calling for the SNP government to engage with DEFRA's upcoming consultation. The Secretary of State and her team have started to set out what they see as their priorities for the future of farming south of the border. But as yet, we know nothing of Scotland's plans. The UK government will seek to scrap the three-crop rule, cut back on red tape, simplify rules and abolish absurd regulations around, for instance, what makes a hedge a hedge. They are also committed to encouraging innovation and efficiency and reducing government inspections through the increased use of technology such as aerial photography. And the Minister shouldn't be using Parliament's time to make political points against Westminster. He should be figuring out what regulations Scotland's farmers can do without and help us to become more efficient. Of course, we know that the government aren't focused on making our farmers more competitive. That is why I've had to write to the Cabinet Secretary on our over-prescriptive greening regulations, for instance. As you will be aware, the unnecessarily strict management rules are holding Scottish farmers back compared to their competitors in England. And I remind the Cabinet Secretary that he has already promised to look at our greening rules and make them fit for purpose. So why doesn't he get on with it? To take an example in vining peas, limited harvesting dates combined with the SNP's own two-crop rule are making this potentially attractive option almost irrelevant in Scotland, while English farmers face no such restrictions. And that is not by any stretch of the imagination the SNP's only failure on managing the rural economy. As we well know, there are still ongoing issues with 2015 CAP payments, with many farmers still waiting for Pillar 2 money as a knock-on effect from the catastrophic handling of Pillar 1 payments. Not only that, but the SNP are at least a month behind where they should be on 2016 Pillar 1 payments. Farmers would usually have expected to have full payment in early December, and as it is, here we are in mid-January, with many farmers having received at best an 80% loan, or indeed nothing at all, and little prospect of payment of the 20% balance before June of this year. Now, is it any wonder that for 2 years in a row, the total income from farming has fallen? From 2014 to 2015, the Scottish Government recorded a fall of £110 million, about 15% in real terms. And on the back of these shocking figures, I fail to see how anyone could be surprised that the finances of the Scottish farming community are in a perilous position. Farm debt has never been higher, increasing by nearly £200 million to a record £2.2 billion, while the SNP failed to deliver CAP monies. Nearly 50% of farmers aren't making enough money to earn the minimum wage, and worse still, 20% of farm business posted losses in 2014. So, what we need to do, we need to take a hard look at the problems that we have seen grow over the last 2 terms in government, and we need, Presiding Officer, I hope this debate is a genuine attempt by the Cabinet Secretary to start the debate about how our future support for Scottish agriculture might look, and not another attempt to drive division and mistrust between here and Westminster. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr Chapman. I now call Rhoda Grant to speak to and move amendment 3463.1. 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all welcome both our government's commitments to funding rural development along current lines until 2020, and that's provided producers and communities with a degree of stability going forward. That said, we know that farming and crofting all involve long-term planning, so 3 years doesn't buy a lot of planning time, so this commitment is at best staving off panic. Therefore, it's right and proper that consultation and discussions as to what takes place beyond 2020 begin now. As is with all discussion about Brexit and the implications, the constitutional question rears its head and too often overshadows the issues that we should be concerned with. Agricultural policy has devolved within the parameters of our status in the EU, and therefore going forward there will be parameters for the whole of the UK set by trade deals and WTO rules. Therefore, it's right and proper that the UK government represent the needs of all our farming communities in these negotiations, and to do so they need to talk to them. We believe that devolved governments have a role in the negotiation of trade deals too, and the UK government would be negligent if it ignored the knowledge and expertise held by them. What we're clear about is that changes to the rules we trade by should not be used to claw back devolved powers. Indeed, quite the opposite. Where powers and decision-making are repatriated, it follows that these powers should come to devolved governments. We put down our amendment today not because we disagree with the direction of travel of the Scottish Government and their need to be involved. However, our motion sets a more positive tone. If both our administrations are to work together for the good of our rural communities, we surely need to lead with a positive approach. This is not the time for party political or constitutional squabbling. Our farmers and crofters cannot be pawns in those political games. With that explanation, therefore, let me turn to what should be the substance of this debate. I think what strikes fear into the hearts of most of our producers is the New Zealand example. New Zealand is often used as an example of what can happen if subsidies are removed, with people pointing at their profitable farm enterprises now. What they don't point out is the number of small farms that went to the wall and the impact that that had on rural communities, and we really don't want that. Therefore, we need to start discussions about what we want and need from our farming communities. Very obviously, the first goal is the aim of food production. We need food security. Leaving the EU and following the currency fluctuations, it makes imports more expensive and therefore imported foodstuffs more expensive. Should we therefore be looking to be more self-sufficient? Our producers will also be looking at exports. A low pound makes their exports more attractive abroad, albeit that if there are trade tariffs in place, this could be offset. And if we do end up with trade tariffs, they will be in place going forward where the value of the pound may stabilise depending on the economic future of our country. The market will always find its place. The role of government intervention is to deal with the problems that creates and to make sure that we are secure. Therefore, we need to look at food production for the home market. There is also a suspicion that farm subsidies are used to fuel the profits of supermarkets, who in turn pay heavy dividends to their shareholders. This can't be right, given that at this moment in time, too many people are living in food poverty. The fact that people in our country, in Scotland, are living without enough food to eat is a disgrace. Any future farming subsidy regime should have the elimination of food poverty built in to its foundations rather than being tagged on as an afterthought. What I find utterly bizarre is in a country whose biggest net export is our fantastic food and drink, we have farms and crofts that can't make a living, and they have neighbours who can't afford the food they need to eat. Yeah. Food poverty isn't inevitable. It's either for producers or consumers. We can choose to end it, and we need to use the future subsidy regime to do that. We also need to look at the needs of rural communities, where many of our producers are based. We need to find a balance between food production profitability and the need to support those rural communities. The EU recognised peripherality and the difficulties faced by remote rural areas in a way that neither of our governments do or indeed have in the past. We know the way the EU rules were interpreted led to them having less of an impact on peripherality than they could have had. But that's in the past. We must learn from these mistakes and make sure that if we're putting public money in, that there are public benefits, and one of these benefits is community cohesion and population retention. Environmental benefits and protection are also things that public money should be supporting. We look at climate change, and we've seen that emissions from farming have hardly changed. We need to use public funding to help that happen. However, we also need to recognise that many of our land managers actually mitigate against climate change by planting trees and land management activities that make the countryside a place for all of us to enjoy. These are balances that need to be struck. We all know that there is not a money tree to shake. However, we also know that without public support, food production, and indeed the community supported by those producers, is likely to fold, and we can't afford that either. This is the time we need to take a holistic view of what needs to happen in the future, how both our governments can support that and what trade deals we can make to enhance it. Scottish Environmental Link have called for a commission of stakeholders to be put in place to look at this, and I tend to agree it might be something that the Scottish Government take to other governments in the United Kingdom to set up a commission jointly that stands, and also one that stands for each of the devolved nations. It's clear that all stakeholders need a voice in this process, and we will therefore be supporting the Liberal Democrats' amendment tonight. Presiding Officer, there are huge challenges we face, but we also have the opportunity to take a long, hard look at what we need to do for the good of our producers. and what they need from their governments, and also how we fix historical problems too. Let's not miss the opportunity by wrangling. Let's grasp it. Let's make a real and lasting difference to how we deal with food production and eliminate fuel poverty in the future.
Please move the amendment.
I move the amendment.
Thank you very much. I call Mike Rumbles to move and speak to and move amendment 3463.2. Mr. Rumbles, 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Well, the United Kingdom's impending withdrawal from the European Union is to bring to an end nearly 40 years of rural development funding under the Common Agricultural Policy. And since the vote to withdraw from the European Union last June, much has been said about the lack of information from the UK government in particular about the future level of this funding. Now, there will be no actual obligation to deliver it. It will be entirely up to the UK and the Scottish governments between them to decide both the level of funding and the way that funding will be delivered. The only thing that is certain about the situation is uncertainty. Although funding is secure until we leave the EU, nothing is certain after that. It's surely the task of both the UK and the Scottish governments to act responsibly here. Too much is at stake for our rural communities for any blame game to take hold about too much or too little funding, or indeed how that funding is to be allocated. That's why I'm pleased that Fergus Ewing has indicated support for my amendment to his motion before us. I've been suggesting gently, and I must admit not so gently sometimes, since September, that it is essential that a group be set up to examine options for designing a new system of delivering public money for public good in our rural economy. As the Liberal Democrat spokesperson for rural development, I've been in discussions with various stakeholders over the period since the vote to leave the EU in June. I'm particularly taken with proposals from both Scottish Environment Link and the National Farmers Union of Scotland. Both have come up with practical suggestions for ways for future funding post-2020. The NFUS say that we need to agree the correct policy direction and also secure the necessary budget. Indeed, I quote from their paper, the real prize will be a future policy framework which is simplified and suited to Scotland's unique landscape and needs and allows the primary producer to take more back from the marketplace, enabling farmers and crofters to become more resilient while delivering at the same time for the market, for consumers, for public good, and for the taxpayer. Scottish Environmental Link agree that we need to retain funding for agricultural and rural development, reshape the way it's given to farming businesses, and thereby renew Scottish agriculture. They say that the key to this is the creation of a commission chaired by an independent person, which within a short time frame would be tasked with getting agreement on a set of policy principles, the principles upon which Scottish agricultural policy frameworks could be based. Can I just finish the point, and I'll come back to Mark. This has formed the basis of my amendment to the government's motion today. If Parliament votes for this at decision time, which I believe it will, then the Scottish Government will set up an independent group of relevant stakeholders to provide advice to them on the principles, the very principles and policies which should underpin the design and delivery of an appropriate system for rural development funding post-2020.
Mark Ruskell.
Thank the member for giving way. Would you see a role in here for the Scottish Land Commission, given its unique role as an independent advisor?
Mr. Rumbles.
I see a role for every person and body that feels that they have something to contribute here. I think we should be inclusive rather than exclusive as far as we can possibly be. Everybody has got something to contribute, I think, here. This is a really radical change and opportunity that we've got we haven't had for 40 years. In my view, this has to be the most sensible way to proceed. And I would have hoped that all parties in the chamber, and I mean all parties, could have supported this amendment regardless of whether or not they support the whole motion in its final form. Now, 2020 might sound as though it's a long way off. However, our rural businesses and stakeholders need to have as much certainty over the future of rural development funding as they can have. We know only too well that there are huge numbers of stakeholders who are reliant on this funding for their very livelihood. The last thing we need are people or organisations digging their heels in and being unwilling to compromise about where limited funds, and these will be limited funds, they will not be unlimited funds, where they are directed. It is really important that as much agreement as is possible is reached among stakeholders about the principles of how these limited funds will be distributed before the next set of discussions take place on the actual level of funding. It's absolutely essential that agreement is reached among stakeholders, that we have a system designed to ensure that the public money that is to be invested for public good is invested in a way that meets the needs of our rural economy. If I may, Presiding Officer, I would like to turn to the Conservative amendment. It's a pity, I have to say, generally to Peter Chapman, that we couldn't have found a situation where all parties could have agreed on the way forward here. I think it's such an important issue that we should, on this issue, have been together. It's interesting that even the Scottish Land and Estates, reading their briefing paper, are disappointed that the Conservative amendment removes a clause in the government motion which happens to regret that the UK government hasn't provided its fair share of funding. Even the Scottish Land and Estates recognise that. I won't say too much more about that, just make the point. But I would say again to Peter Chapman, that he knows, and he talked about the Common Agricultural Policy, he knows there's no fiercer critic of the way the Common Agricultural Policy farm payments have been rolled out than myself. But today of all days, should not be about CAP payments. It's about trying to get agreement on the way forward for a new system of rural development funding. Now, we agree and support with Labour's amendment, especially where it says where powers are repatriated from the EU, they should be devolved in line with the 1998 Scotland Act. Should we have to say that? I just can't believe that wouldn't happen. It would really be unacceptable if that did not happen. And I think Parliament should speak as one voice here. Now, there's much work to be done in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer. Fergus Ewing, as the Minister responsible for this process, has a huge task ahead of him. I want him to know that the Scottish Liberal Democrats will support him in this endeavour of designing a new system of public support for rural Scotland, because the aim of having a successful and vibrant rural economy post-2020 is a name we share.
Thank you very much. We're now going to move to the open debate. Very tight 6 minutes, Chairman. Can I remind members who've intervened the requested sweet buttons go off? You get press them again. I call Emma Harper to follow by Finlay Carson. Ms Harper, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to remind members that I am the Parliamentary Liaison Officer for the Cabinet Secretary, Mr Ewing. Securing the future of funding for rural development in Scotland has always been an important issue. However, against the backdrop of this week's confirmation that the Prime Minister is indeed determined to rip us out of the single market, it has taken on an even greater sense of urgency. Rural Scotland accounts for 98% of the land mass in Scotland, and nearly a fifth of the population are resident there. Future funding for rural development, as the motion is titled, is more than what the definition of a hedge is. Membership of the EU is worth billions to the rural economy, much more than the £4 billion received in EU funding. Permanent and short-term migrants add considerable value when they come here to work in the agriculture, tourism and food and drink sectors. The issue of EU nationals working in the food supply chain and the uncertainty surrounding their future is a real concern. A concern Theresa May continues to fuel with her red, white and blue rhetoric. These are skilled workers whose departure will do real damage to the economy. And while rural Scotland is a beautiful place to live and work, there are stubborn pockets of deprivation, a result of a combination of factors such as remoteness and an ageing population. Rural communities and the UK as a whole have benefited immensely from EU funding, and it is time the Westminster Government acknowledged that, as well as the impact the removal of that money will inevitably have. Tuesday's announcement by Theresa May was devastating. The hard Brexit for which we are now headed will be especially cruel to our rural communities. It represents a two-pronged attack which will see them simultaneously stripped of EU funding, while the industries underpinning their economy will be effectively denied access to their biggest market by prohibitive tariffs. Currently, Scotland receives 16.5% of the UK's cap funds. From 2014 to 2020, Scotland would have received around €4.6 billion under cap from EU, €477 million of which is delivered via Pillar 2 funds for rural development. In the lead-up to the referendum, pro-Brexit campaigners insisted that all agricultural funding would be protected. We were told assuredly that Westminster would equally redistribute that silver bullet of £350 million a week it would allegedly save from no longer funding the EU. To quote the Farming Minister directly, the UK government will continue to give farmers and the environment as much support, or perhaps even more, as they get now. But earlier this month, both the Secretary of State and the Minister refused to confirm that funding would match the current levels beyond 2020. Likewise, the Scottish Secretary, David Mundell, promised to, and I quote, ensure that Scotland gets the best possible deal, and that deal clearly involves being part of the single market. However, yesterday, he appeared to give up on membership of the single market completely. When asked by a BBC presenter, aren't you a Scottish Secretary to defend the interests of the Scottish people in the Cabinet? He astonishingly replied, no. Of course, it is not just the agricultural sector that is set to lose out. In Scotland, EU funding has helped to support the rollout of superfast broadband, business development, housing investment and improvements to infrastructure. For 5 years, I have listened to my colleague Joan McAlpine speak about the importance of securing NUTS 2 status for the south of Scotland. The Scottish Government had approved plans to amend current boundaries, which could have made the region eligible for an uplift of £840 million from the EU. The prospect of the south of Scotland now missing out on that transformative amount of funding is bitterly disappointing. That's £840 million that the south of Scotland folks will never see. £840 million that could have made a real difference to their lives. That's now in jeopardy. To listen to the Brexit cheerleaders at Westminster and in this chamber even, you would believe that in the EU, it has contributed nothing tangible to the rural communities we represent. EU funding has made a huge difference to Dumfries and Galloway, and its removal has serious implications. Local projects are currently being funded by grants from the European Social Fund. Actually, no, because I want to proceed, so thanks. Local projects are currently being funded by grants from the European Social Fund for Employability, £7 million. The European Regional Development Fund is worth £1.4 million, and the LEADER programme is worth about £6.1 million. These grants alone support the jobs of some 50 staff directly employed to deliver these schemes. And many more partners rely on this and other funding to support employment. These jobs are now in jeopardy. Will the Tories at Westminster, who have caused this mess, commit to replacing that money? This is really the reality of Brexit. There is no doubt that our exit from the EU and the loss of funding opportunities will hinder our efforts to create a sustainable future for Scotland. But the EU referendum result does not reduce our desire to protect Scotland and the rural economy. The SNP government will exhaust every avenue to create conditions under which Scotland will flourish. There can be an absolutely no question of the UK government attempting to reserve powers currently devolved to the Scottish Parliament.
Close now, please.
They have proven 100 times over that they cannot be entrusted with the task of protecting Scotland's interests. Thank you.
Finlay Carson, followed by Gail Ross.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this afternoon's debate on the future of funding for rural development, one which gives members from all sides of the Chamber the chance to raise the profile of our rural communities and highlight some of the excellent work that goes on in them. I also welcome the Cabinet Secretary's New Year's resolution and look forward to holding him to it. Unfortunately, Emma Harper, gripe and grievance has crept in again, and it seems to be the order of the day from the government benches. and its appeal, which is really wearing thin. We need to forget about what's happened in the past, get on with the job of getting the best deal for Scotland in the future. We must not allow the Scottish Government to use the smokescreen of Brexit to avoid getting on with the job of getting the best deal. Earlier this week, the UK Prime Minister, Theresa May, set out a clear and credible plan ahead of triggering Article 50 by the end of the month. In her speech, Mrs May was very clear in her commitment to delivering a Brexit that works for the whole of the United Kingdom. That's why the Scottish Government are fundamentally incorrect when they claim that they are being sidelined and ignored. They should stop their rhetoric and political gesturing and get round the table to help secure the best deal from the negotiations. Because that's what our rural communities deserve. As already been mentioned, leaving the European Union means that we will have the ability to deliver a system that best meets the needs for those who work in our agricultural sector. Brexit allows the UK to design a new system support from first principles. We have the chance to address the priorities we have in Scotland to support and reward efficiency and innovation, promote sustainable production, ensure habitat and species protection, and require primary producers to consumers to work in a sensitive and correct way to ensure the supply chain is fair from primary producer to processor and consumer.
Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you very much. And by the way, I'd just say I hear and agree with a great deal of what I'm hearing from the member. But he talked about collaboration between the Scottish Government and the UK Government, and indeed Welsh and Northern Irish. Can he tell us one thing only, that any of the devolved administrations have successfully got the UK Government to change its policy on in relation to negotiation?
Finlay Carson.
I think that I'll leave that to the Scottish Government to tell us, because they're the guys that are sitting around the table. We've just started negotiations, and I would like to think that, unlike in the past, that our Cabinet Secretary will be able to go down to London and do the best thing for the Scottish rural economy. The NFU in Scotland considered that this is a real opportunity to design and implement a new system appropriate to Scotland's unique circumstances and farming systems, and will create environmental protection, innovation and profitability. And this will be one of the real prizes of these negotiations, Presiding Officer. In a speech at the start of this month, Andrea Leadsom correctly pointed out that for far too long, a bureaucratic system which tries to meet the needs of 28 different member states has only held farmers back. Post-Brexit, it will be for the Scottish Government to decide what the priorities will be in terms of funding for Scottish agricultural sector and rural development, and we must start that hard work now. My only worry about that, though, is whether they are capable of delivering it. One only has to look at the Government's shambolic track record and management of the current CAP payment systems, and you're presented with a catalogue of failures. Let's not forget that as a result of this SNP government's mishandling of the system, farmers, the length and breadth of Scotland, were left worried about their cash flow and the knock-on effect in Scotland's rural economy left it on the brink of collapse. Only last week, the NFUS called for a step change in the CAP system, IT system, which continues to affect Pillar 2 schemes, and millions of pounds from 2015 schemes are still to enter farmers' banks' account. A ridiculous situation. Farmers want certainty, and that's exactly what the UK Government provided them with when the Chancellor of Exchequer guaranteed that all Pillar 2 payments signed before we leave the EU will be guaranteed for their lifetime, and Pillar 1 payments are guaranteed to 2020. This welcome announcement provided farmers with an important assurance that they're going to be financially supported throughout the negotiations as the UK leaves the EU. It's time that the Scottish Government started to be optimistic about our future post-Brexit. We are going to be presented with a unique chance to start from scratch and come up with our own support system, which will be within the deal that the UK negotiates with all areas of the UK. Such a system has the potential to support a rural economy in a way that the current system simply does not allow. In their briefing, the NFUS outlined a number of potential measures, including incentives to improve efficiency and productivity, initiatives to promote and assist collaboration, schemes to prevent environmental damage and enhance environment, and more support for new entrants and developers. To conclude, Presiding Officer, We on these benches are ambitious for Scotland's rural communities, less red tape and a unique Scottish system with more control over our priorities. Scotland's rural communities need a Scottish Government ready to embrace these opportunities and to be open-minded and imaginative about how to deliver it. The UK voted to leave the EU, and we might now need to do the right thing for Scotland. I welcome the opportunity to work with Mr Ewing and help him keep his New Year's resolution.
Thank you. Please remember we're tight for time. Gail Ross, followed by Claudia Beard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Here it is. Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Highlands and Islands has been transformed by European support over the years. A place where roads, bridges and other important infrastructure has been built with support from the European Community and then the European Union. Indeed, if you were to take the North Coast 500 route, which is largely in my constituency, you would see a multitude of EU flags on signs at the sides of roads and on bridges built by European funds. And that is just one legacy of the EU that we will have, but unfortunately that potential has now been lost. And that is not a gripe nor a grievance, it's a real and tangible worry. Education, agriculture and renewable energy are sectors which throughout the years have greatly added to the economy and society of rural areas. These three sectors have benefited and continue to benefit from European cooperation and support. In terms of education, I've said so in this chamber before, the decision to wrench Scotland from the EU could not be clearer. The University of the Highlands and Islands will be worse hit than any other university in Scotland. 35% of external funding for UHI comes from the EU, so that means that there is a potential cut to UHI of over one third of their budget, and that's a figure that should make everyone in this chamber pause for thought. And it's not just funding that will be lost to UHI. Pan-European academic cooperation, such as the Horizon 2020 scheme, which UHI has been playing a leading role, is a chance to swap ideas on and find solutions to a range of issues, including carbon reduction and offshore development. Also set to go is the chance to participate in the Erasmus Plus programme, which for decades has given both students and lecturers a chance to interact and collaborate with colleagues across the continent. These benefits of the experiences are intangible, and we will be poorer for it passing. There has been great investment in UHI over the years from the EU. In fact, the EU has been at the heart of the UHI since it has started, and indeed it's a great shame to see it end this way. And I do have real fears, as do the members of the UHI, for the groundbreaking and excellent work that it has achieved, and especially in the ERI, the Environmental Research Institute in Thurso. Moving on to farming, forestry, fisheries and the food and drink sector, the situation, in my opinion, could not be more stark. These are key players in many rural areas and these sectors which receive the greatest support from the EU. As Emma Harper already said, over £4 billion worth of funding from 2014 to 2020, and this tells its own story. It helps create jobs, it underpins communities, but it also creates landscapes where the land is used, which helps with the ecology, as well as putting food on our table. In short, it allows people to live, farm and contribute in our rural areas. European support for farming cuts across the whole industry, whether it be arable fields to sweeping hillsides. But beyond 2020, the future is uncertain, and rightly, people in these communities are concerned by what will happen. No, thank you. As I have mentioned, there are many schemes to support farming. One such scheme which helps is the Less Favoured Area Scheme, or LFAS. This comes under Pillar 2 of CAP, and it's directed at those people who farm on marginal lands, and they turn a marginal profit. They are our crofters and hill farmers. LFAS land accounts for 85% of the landmass of Scotland. The funding for LFAS is more than vital to these areas, and it's critical, and the great worry for me and others is the fact that, as the Cabinet Secretary said, the UK Government have not committed to funding for applications in 2019. That's only 2 years away. This situation is something that Fergus Ewan has brought up with the UK Government, and I add my voice to that today. Presiding Officer, one of our greatest exports we have is food and drink, and a hard Brexit, as they put it, could threaten much more of our export to the EU, which is our closest and biggest market. The food and drink industry directly employs around 116,000 people, and many of those are in rural areas. One question that needs clarity is that of the agricultural sector and how the funding will go forward from the arable farmer to the hill crofter. These people help influence the biodiversity of many rural areas, and they create the communities that are so important. The CAP system, whilst not perfect, has helped protect that way of life for many years, and it's important that whatever post-Brexit may bring, there needs to be a way to allow this way of life to continue. Renewables is another sector that has received sustained backing via the EU and helps deliver high-quality jobs in rural areas, whether it be the Beatrice Offshore Development, which has received hundreds of millions of support and is due to create hundreds of jobs in construction and maintenance, or the recent money to help develop the MayGen Tidal Energy Scheme. Presiding Officer, if we are serious about supporting our rural areas, if we value them, then we need to recognise that they have been immeasurably improved by funding and support that the EU has given over the years. It is incumbent on the UK Government to listen to and work with the Scottish Government to make sure that post-Brexit, our rural communities get the help they need and to make sure that they are not left behind following the loss of major funding streams that our exit from the EU will cause. In my opinion, the best solution for the future of rural funding is remaining in the EU. Thank you.
Claudia Beamish, to be followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today, with the laying of the draft climate change plan, I want to start by focusing on that issue. Agriculture and related land use accounts for 22.8% of Scotland's total greenhouse gas emissions, although it must be recognised that the 1990 agricultural emissions have decreased by 25%. We can all acknowledge that as the third heaviest emitting sector, improvements must be made in the greening of our farming sector appropriately, and I use that word advisedly, appropriate to Scotland. Furthermore, it seems that Scotland will not meet the biodiversity targets for 2020 and is ranked in the lowest fifth of all countries analysed in the Intactness Index. Amid the uncertainty of the future of CAP, I am concerned that any further progress may falter. Our farmers are not only the producers of food, they also act, of course, as custodians of our land. 75% of Scotland's landmass is used for agricultural production, and the sector directly employs 63,000 people. Limiting global warming is a responsibility we all share, but we must respect the farmers' shoulders can be expected to bear a brunt of this, and it is unreasonable to demand and expect these business owners and rural communities to act in the public interest without providing them with proper support in the transition. There are brilliant examples of positive changes farmers can make, and I commend the 9 monitor farms in Scotland, some of which are in my region. By sharing knowledge, these farmers have improved their own sustainability and profitability and shared that with others. It is paramount that agricultural workers are brought with us in the forefront of the green shift, and Scottish Labour will fight for farmers' rights, yes, rights, in trade negotiations, rural policy, and in securing a just transition. In future, I see a strong and sustainable Scottish agriculture sector, food production and climate mitigation fully integrated. Even before the Brexit vote, Scotland spent the second least amount on agri-environment schemes from the CAP Pillar 2 per hectare in the EU. As we are faced with an opportunity to reconsider the agricultural subsidy regime, I urge the Scottish Government to link the two with a bottom-up approach. I want to take the opportunity today briefly to specify 3 aspects of our rural economy to emphasise the necessity and benefits of support for rural Scotland leading to and beyond 2020 in the context of my opening remarks. The first is the need for more support for the organic sector and for continuing consideration by the Scottish Government of the benefits of agroecology. In my own region of South Scotland, I have been welcomed to Whitmore Organics several times by the owners, Pete Ritchie and Heather Anderson. Their commitment to organic production shows, along with other organic producers, what is possible. And I also applaud the Soil Association's contribution. In relation to climate change, the Research Institute of Organic Agriculture states The main mitigation potential lies in the capacity of soils to sequester CO2 through the building of organic matter. This potential can be realised by employing sustainable agriculture practices such as those commonly found in organic farming methods. Of course, good soil husbandry is essential across the agriculture sector, and many farmers, while not in receipt of organic certification, manage their soils and wider businesses for a better climate and for biodiversity. Those that do not must be supported and also, I argue, expected to do so, not least because they are in receipt of public money. Secondly, I want to stress the need for support for innovation. In order to develop new systems and build confidence, support is essential post-Brexit. Sad, as though I have to say that last bit. I use the example of agroforestry or silvopasture, depending on whether speaking in today's debate or next Tuesday's on forestry. The Forestry Commission Scotland recognises the significance of agroforestry. The United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization states, agroforestry's mixed land use approach makes it a tailor-made example of how the agricultural sector can contribute to the global effort to curb greenhouse gas emissions. And significantly, the UK Committee on Climate Change has stated a new policy was required to address barriers and awareness to agroforestry. Thirdly, I want to highlight the continuing importance of the cooperative models in rural Scotland. As a member of the parliamentary group of Scottish Cooperative Party members, the Scottish Agricultural Organisation Society does a terrific job in supporting cooperatives across rural Scotland. And James Graham, their secretary, states, farmer cooperatives are self-help businesses that add to the development of both economic and social capital in rural Scotland, investing and employing in areas where PLC businesses will not. And the government EU pillar grants, the EU pillar two grants, assist investment and access to facilitation of cooperatives and community groups and are essential. And they are food processing, marketing and cooperation grant scheme and the knowledge transfer and innovation fund and leader, and we must protect these or similar funds. I hope these three examples stress the need for continued Scottish Government support across rural Scotland. Together, we can bring a healthier and more equal society, as highlighted by Rhoda Grant, my colleague, and a stronger rural economy. Thank you.
Stuart Stevenson, to be followed by Edward Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and let me start by drawing members' attention to my extremely large 3-acre registered agricultural holding, from which I receive no income whatsoever. I'm an MSP for an intensely rural area of Scotland, dependent on farming and fishing, albeit we have other industries as well. And may I start on a very consensual note and say how very much I welcome Peter Chapman's response to my intervention that we would be guaranteed a minimum of 16.4% of agricultural support that there is in the UK going forward. However, let's give a little bit of context to that, because we might perhaps consider whether in the light of a tweet from George Eustace on the 4th of January that said subsidies post-2020 for farmers there will be no more subsidies for farmers post-2020. So I'm not much in... One moment, please, really. I'm not much encouraged that 16.4% of nothing is quite what probably Peter Chapman, certainly myself, had in mind. And, of course, also what George Eustace said earlier and before the referendum on the 26th of May was we would have as much support or perhaps even more once the referendum was out of the way. I accept, by the way, that we're dealing with where they are. Do forgive me, I'm going to take the Tory spokesman first, if I may. Mr. Chapman.
Peter Chapman.
The member makes a point that he feels that there'll be no support. I don't accept that in any way, shape or form. I have had meetings with Andrea Leadsom and George Eustace, and none of the two of them said anything of the sort, that there would be no support going forward after 2020.
Stuart Stevenson.
I know my opposite number on the Tory benches is an honest and straightforward man, and I'm very pleased to hear him say that. But I can only repeat that George Eustace tweeted on the 4th of January. Now, putting it in 140 characters, I accept, can sometimes eliminate meaning, but the specific words he used were no more subsidies post-2020. I invite, in a spirit of collaboration, I invite the member to make further communication with his political colleagues and establish whether the meaning has been eliminated by the words that were actually used. Now, we've all been quoting from various sources. That's what we as politicians inevitably will do. And the NFUS has properly been quoted as an important player in this particular policy area. Claire Slipper yesterday in her blog following the Prime Minister's speech said, NFU Scotland wants barrier and tariff-free trade as well as the freedom to set our own appropriate rules for farming. Now, I accept that the objectives that the Prime Minister laid out in her speech are ones I don't find it terribly difficult to agree with, by the way, because they are probably the objectives that in the current circumstance we would all think are proper. I think the difficulty lies in what confidence we may or may not have in an ability to achieve agreement with 27 other countries in the delivery of something that supports the objectives. I don't think we've time for my 6 minutes, rather less than that now, to explore what that means. But we have to have better relationships in Europe. And I genuinely hope that the UK government does draw upon all the devolved ministers who have an interest in this to be part of a collegiate team who are individually going and engaging with different countries across Europe. I've attended as a minister more than 20 EU councils of one sort or another, and in that environment I used to have the particular countries that I, as a UK representative, had responsibility for. That's a good model going forward. And by the way, that was under both the Labour government and the Conservative government. So I know it can work. It needs to work again if we have to get the kind of result that we want. Because fundamentally for Scotland, the money that comes in the EU is very, very significant for farming, of course, but also the LEADER programme has been enormous help to people in my constituency. 64,000 recently to Macduff Scout Group, 4,000 for the North East Preservation Trust for work in Port Soy, 9,500 for Port Soy Players, 90,000 for Scottish Enterprise for a development project in the Banff area. I'm sure other members will make their own references to local circumstances. So it is important that we are able to continue to support our rural areas, because it isn't simply, of course, a matter for rurality. The quality of life in rural areas is important to attracting in professional support that will often be working in urban areas. So therefore, there is a benefit to supporting rural areas that is translated into a benefit in urban areas as well. We're not clear that the Prime Minister at the moment has the same kind of priorities that we are expressing across the political divide in this chamber for the rural economy. When the Prime Minister talked about disbenefits of not achieving a result between the UK and the 27 EU, she was talking about the disadvantages for the EU members. There are, of course, substantial disadvantages for the UK and in particular for Scotland as well. So I wish her well. I wish her well, but I have limited optimism. Wales is doing well. They're on the same page as we are.
Mr. Stevenson, must come to a close.
And I hope that we can support, at the end of tonight, all of us, the motion that we have as amended by Labour and Liberal. I hope the Tories will do that.
Edward Mountain, to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to refer members to my register of interest. And I will say at the outset that I will take some interventions, especially from those members that refuse me interventions if they feel that they want to, but if they could let me get a little way into what I'm going to say before they do so. Before I look forward, I'd like to look on the past and reflect a wee bit on that so we can understand where we want to be post-2020. For those in this chamber and those who were involved in farming or agricultural policy in 1992, you will remember the excesses of that time. there were lots of unwanted mountains. Mountains of butter, mountains of beef, mountains of cheese, to name but a few. And then there were a predictable intervention, and I'm glad I allowed you, so I won't allow you back in later. And there were lakes, lakes of wine and lakes of milk. Not that any of us saw them, but that we knew they existed. And we knew they existed within the EU. And I'm pleased to say that those unwanted mountains are now a thing of the past. And that came about because of the McSherry reforms. And those reforms were needed because the Common Agricultural Policy was built purely on dealing with food deficits. And it boosted productions beyond the needs. In 1991, just to put that into context, we were sitting on 3.7 billion ECUs of goods. Too much, which were really beyond even us in Europe shifting to the rest of the world. And let's take out some other interesting points at that stage. 50% of all the community farmers were over 55. It was accepted by all that the CAP budget, based on intervention, was out of control. There was not enough work done to improve the environment. Farming lacked new entrants. Rural development had been limited to the primary farming sector. Policies have been driven by a lack of understanding on interdependence between countries. Farms with the necessary capacity needed to become more competitive. And support for farmers have been driven to inflating food prices, which remained artificially high. These details were taken from the Commission of the European Communities report dated the 1st of February 1991. And my view that some 26 years later, with massive subsidies having been paid to farmers, many of the comments are equally valid today as they were then. Now, I'd like to... I've already taken one comment from you. I will take them from other people in a moment. Now, I'd like to mention two other facts that seem to slide many commentators by. Firstly, I've looked back to 1992 and referenced back to today. And although there have always been winners and losers, the level of farm payments to farmers have always been on a downward direction of travel. Secondly, whatever scheme has been introduced by the EU, there has always been an effort made to fit all, and I stress all of Europe. Set aside and the three crop rule are but two examples. So the past was not always perfect. So looking to the future, I just say that I find the government's motion tonight a bit depressing. Not every glass is half empty, some glasses can be half full, and this is certainly reflected in what Scottish fishermen believe. It's not all doom and gloom. I believe we can design a system that looks to the needs of the UK in the same way that the current system looks to the needs of the EU. By agreeing, and this is the critical part, a UK framework and ensuring control of the exact details and implementation in Scotland is retained by the Scottish Parliament, as it is now, we can be assured with careful negotiation that the government get the best deal. Now, for those of you on my right who might find that a difficult concept to understand, what I'm suggesting is working together as part of a team with negotiations, with consensual agreement, with a light touch, something that I think we can do. But what of the future? Let me tell you what I think it must be, and I'm going to give you three quick examples, if I may. It must be simple to administer, cutting red tape, ditching complex computers, be received by those that the scheme is targeting, and deliver public good while protecting the environment. And let me be clear, before I'm accused of wanting to cut basic payment supports, I don't. And I believe that farmers and the rural economy need support. I will take an intervention as no one else has intervened.
Thank you very much. I thought you might. I wonder if the member, and he may well agree with me on this, would agree that there are also social objectives associated with supporting rural economies that perhaps were very strong, particularly in the early days of CAP. We've got to get them right, got to get the right balance, but there are also social objectives beyond simply farming.
You have less than a minute, Mr. Mountain.
I'm just going to say that I absolutely believe that rural support is not just for farmers. It is for achieving things for the countryside and for the countryside as a whole. Now, I was going to add at that stage that I probably know as well as anyone else in this chamber the importance of support to the rural economy. And what I'd like to go on and just say now, as I'm coming to the last moments of my speech is that I don't know all the answers, but together I believe we can work them out. So what needs to happen now is that all stakeholders need to get together in Scotland and work with the Cabinet Secretary and decide what Scotland needs. We then need to engage with the UK government, and at my recent meetings with Andrea Leadsom and George Eustace, they've made it clear that's exactly what they're waiting for. So, as I've said before in this chamber, farmers are can-do people who respond to what they see in front of them, and I welcome the opportunity to work with the Cabinet Secretary, as he offered to do at the beginning of this debate, to take rural subsidies and support for Scotland forward.
I call on Willie Coffey to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer, and I'll try and get this under the 6 minutes at your request. I'm very pleased to be able to contribute to the debate on funding for rural development in Scotland and to offer the Chamber a perspective on this as an Ayrshire MSP. According to the Scottish Rural College's very detailed and recent publication, Rural Scotland in Focus, rural areas make up about 98% of the landmass of Scotland. They're home to over 1 million of Scotland's population and have 1/3 of its registered small and medium-sized enterprises with about 50,000 businesses in total. The publication offers us an important perspective on the rural economy with many contributions for farmers and small business owners, and I commend it to colleagues in the Chamber. Presiding Officer, Ayrshire and the southwest of Scotland, in particular in Dumfries and Galloway, plays a huge part in the agricultural economic landscape of rural Scotland, with 80% of Scotland's dairy herd and nearly 800 specialist dairy farms being located in that wonderful part of our country. It's important, therefore, that the potential consequences of the changes that are certain to come in rural development funding and their disproportionate impact in the southwest of Scotland are fully considered and debated. I'm grateful too for the briefings that we did receive from the NFU Scotland over the last couple of days, one just before the Prime Minister's announcements this week and the other just after it. They did provide a useful and focused summary of the main issues of concern. In particular, they described the potential decimation, as they put it, of Scottish agriculture if a future funding arrangement post-Brexit does not mirror current arrangements where 16% of the UK's total CAP funding comes to Scotland, but potentially under a possible Barnett funding arrangement, this could shrink to just 8 or 9%. The UK government, I think, must give a clear commitment to maintain this support now at this current level and remove what is perhaps one of the greatest concerns for our farmers. With 85% of Scotland's land designated as less favoured, but the converse being true in England, NFU Scotland also argues that a devolved agricultural policy for solution for Scotland is likely to be necessary. None of this needs to wait until the outcome of negotiations with the EU. All it takes, I think, is for the UK government to give those commitments now. However, speeches from UK ministers before the EU vote were full of promises that farmers would get as much support, or perhaps even more than they get now. But now we hear that there will be no more subsidies after 2020, and only this morning we get no assurances that farm payments will not be cut after 2020. Presiding Officer, food and drink producers in Ayrshire and Arran are renowned for quality, and their products are in demand throughout Europe and right across the world. We have exceptional beef, lamb, pork and game, world-class fish and shellfish, the Ayrshire tatty that was mentioned by the Cabinet Secretary, award-winning Dunlop cheese, wonderful ice creams, handmade chocolates, craft beers and distinctive whiskies, Musgeal milk, and only last week, another world award for Browning's now famous steak and Scotch pies. All of this contributes to Scotland's reputation as a world-class producer and exporter of quality food and drink. It accounts for about 30% of Scotland's total exports, compared to about 7% in the UK, and represents a turnover for us of about £14 billion, employing over 100,000 people. This sector is utterly crucial to Scotland and is our biggest export to the EU, worth about £2 billion. Unless the UK government can get a deal agreed with the EU within 2 years after the Brexit button has been pressed, which many say is unlikely, the whole sector could be facing a disastrous period where tariffs are reimposed and access to the wider market, even beyond Europe, is restricted or at worst closed off. What an utterly scandalous and unnecessary situation for Ayrshire and Scottish food producers to be facing. Now, one very important area, not just for the rural economy, is whether the UK is also intending to walk away from the European digital single market. While the Tories are planning their escape from the single market itself, it surely makes no sense whatsoever to walk away from further integration of digital services across Europe. The digital single market is worth about €415 billion to the whole European economy and will offer €11 billion in savings for consumers shopping online. Are we to walk away from that too? And in June of this year, when data roaming charges for mobile phone users in Europe are finally flattened out, are the Tories going to triumphantly bring back roaming charges for millions of people in the UK who will still go on holiday to Europe after Brexit? I can see that going down like a lead balloon. Presiding officer, rushing towards a conclusion, living and working in the rural economy was never easy, but this unnecessary and uncertain future being imposed on many of our Scottish farmers and food and drink producers is surely one of the most unnecessary acts of political folly we've ever seen. No matter how the Brexiteers try to dress this up as a golden opportunity, the harsh reality is that timescales here are nigh on impossible, and Scotland's key agriculture, food and drink sectors face the grim prospect of a return of tariffs and restricted market access. As usual, the Scottish Government will do what we can in our powers to protect our producers from the damage to come. But if the signs aren't good, I have no doubt that Scottish people will exercise their right to steer that different course that offers them a better and more secure future. Thank you.
Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Mary Evans.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Funding for rural development and agriculture is a recognition of the vital role played by land managers and communities in protecting, preserving and enhancing the natural environment that is so vital to our identity and our livelihoods. And that's why it's vitally important that we maintain rural development funding during this constitutionally uncertain time. The repatriation of powers from Europe to Scotland and the devolution of additional powers as called for in today's motion will go some way towards protecting Scotland from the hard Brexit announced by the Prime Minister this week. But the starting point to build a progressive future for our rural communities that we need has to be a commission that looks at a fundamental question. What are we trying to deliver from farming? And what are the tools that we need to achieve this? Now, such a commission needs to be broad. It needs to be cross-sectoral and independent. And this work cannot be delivered by a single part-time industry secondment here or even a sector champion there. Now, thankfully, this Parliament has just approved such a body with the status and the remit to deliver, the Scottish Land Commission. And there's never been a more important time for this commission to come into being and focus on this critical question. Its independence, its expertise on delivery of public interest, and its connection with vulnerable agricultural communities makes it uniquely placed to lead consideration of this question, marshalling fairly all those with a stake in our farming future. And there's a lot of reform to consider, Presiding Officer. For example, during the current SRDP round, it's being delivered through 14 different funding schemes. These schemes themselves are administered by 5 different government departments and agencies. It can be a complex and bewildering process, especially for new entrants and small family-run farms. While the Farm Advisory Scheme should go some way towards addressing this, there are more important, there are improvements which can be made. There are now growing calls, for example, to establish an agency which not only sets out the vision and values that we have for future Scottish agricultural sector, but actually takes on the task of administering payments and support in a joined-up manner. A Scottish Food and Farming Agency could take the form of a non-departmental government body, bringing together farmers, land managers, environmental NGOs, researchers, and representatives from rural communities to ensure that our vision of a good food nation is delivered. The creation of a national agency would not necessarily mean greater centralisation of rural development policy and funding. Rather, this could be used to facilitate greater participation in rural development through local decision-making panels and regional distribution of specific funds. And let me give you an example of this. The LEADER programme has been one of the major success stories of the SRDP, due to deliver over £80 million worth of funding during the current CAP phase through the local action group model. Now, this supports local rural communities to identify the challenges they face and support grassroots solutions. In my own region, as Stuart Stevenson's already alluded to, a diverse range of projects have been funded by LEADER since 2007. We've got the Fife Rural Skills Partnership, the Balquhidder Community Broadband Company. And although these projects address very different aspects of rural life, they've provided direct employment for local people and are addressing the need for skills and infrastructure that have helped people find employment, set up businesses, and contribute to thriving rural local economies. Other aspects of current SRDB funding would benefit greatly from local decision-making that a national agency could facilitate. For example, rural enterprises could collectively establish their own training schemes through Knowledge Transfer and Innovation Fund that provides training close to home, which addresses specific needs in their area. Or regional farmers' cooperatives, Claudia Beamish has already spoken about, could get support from their local decision-making board to submit a competitive and viable bid, for example, for public procurement. Cooperative models still play a central role in the delivery of rural and farming policy in other parts of Europe, including in France, where they've adopted a world-leading agroecology model for farming policy. I believe that this should be a key method in delivering a future rural development policy which understands and meets the needs of our remote rural communities. Let me turn briefly to subsidies, because while we remain committed to keeping Scotland in the European Union, we're not naive to the failings of CAP. And we'd urge the government during this time of constitutional crisis to continue engaging the debate taking place in Europe about the future of CAP. And in particular, the principle of direct payments, according to land area contained in Pillar 1, has directly contributed to the consolidation of farms into ever larger units, and it has pushed the price of land up beyond the reach of many local people across Scotland. Since area-based direct payments were introduced in 2004, land prices across the UK as a whole have tripled, and the UK government has persistently refused to introduce measures permitted by the EU to taper payments for larger farms. The winners under this system are clearly not rural communities, but the richest landowners in our society. The Queen herself received over £500,000 in single farm payments last year. Unless it undergoes radical reforms, the principle of direct area-based payments are not something we could support in any future subsidy system. Presiding Officer, the job of protecting Scotland's rural interests starts with building a progressive vision of our land and the communities that need to thrive on it. I believe that the Scottish Land Commission is the right body to marshal that vision.
Thank you. And the last of the open speakers is Mary Evans.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I took part in the debate at the tail end of last year on the impact that leaving the European Union would have on the rural economy, and primarily focused on the importance of funding in that debate. Because during the whole EU referendum debate, the one thing that I found particularly frustrating was the lack, what I seem to see is the lack of focus on the extent to which EU funding underpins so many different services and diverse projects locally and nationally that are absolutely vital to our economy and to our society. And that's why I therefore welcome the government motion today, because while we now know, or we have a better idea of what the Westminster government's negotiating position will be, for the better or for the worse, depending on where you sit in this chamber, we need to continue to fight for fair funding for our rural economy, as well as for the devolution of additional powers, so that we can really best protect the interests of all of rural Scotland. But I'd like to start today by setting out the context and outlining exactly what is at stake during this period of negotiation by looking at my own constituency. Now, Aberdeenshire Council actually published a report, a very interesting report, that went to their Policy and Resources Committee today about their EU referendum position, which actually very helpfully illustrates this information and very clearly outlines what Aberdeenshire needs to see from any negotiations with the EU. And I really would urge any North East MSPs in particular, if they haven't had a look at this report, to do so. Now, the report outlines in terms of fishing that Aberdeenshire is Scotland's foremost fishing area. The region accounts for 56.4% of all fish landed into Scotland by value. And together with Aberdeen, it provides 31% of Scotland's regular fisheries employment. Moreover, since 2010, the quantity of fish landings in the North East has increased by 23% and total employment by 5.4%. When it comes to agriculture, Aberdeenshire has 26% of the national arable land total, despite having 9% of overall land. The sectors of forestry, fishing, and agriculture between them employ around 6,000 people. Now, these sectors, which will receive around £4 billion of EU funds, are absolutely vital to our rural and wider economy, and the continuation of EU funding is crucial for the continued viability of these areas. But as has already been highlighted today, it's not just these sectors directly that benefit from rural development funding, but our own local communities and local community groups through schemes such as LEADER, as I say, that's already been highlighted by a few other members today. Again, in my constituency, this funding amounted to £2.8 million for South Aberdeenshire for the current funding period and £2.7 million for Angus, and that excludes the extra monies that tend to be levered in on the back of that. Now, funds such as this have had a huge impact and continue to have a growing impact in our local communities, helping a huge variety of different projects. And there's one example that I'm particularly keen to highlight to members today, and it's one that's not actually quite in my constituency. I hope Graham Day doesn't mind me going into his territory in Angus South, because this is the point where we go from farming, fishing and forestry to rock. And by rock, I don't mean the geological variety, but the kind that comes with lightning bolts, guitars, drums, and loud vocals. Now, this was a project in Kirriemuir with DD8 Music, a community organisation with the aim of working with young people. Now, through LEADER, they were able to find premises, which they turned into a recording studio, providing them with a base and a completely new and exciting facility from which they've been able to build and build as an organisation. Now, DD8 Music now organises one of the main festivals in the northeast of Scotland, which I hope you've all heard of, Bonfest. Now, what is Bonfest? I might hear you cry. Bonfest is a celebration of Bon Scott, the legendary AC/DC vocalist who was from Kirriemuir in Angus, and which attracts rockers and fans, of which I am a huge one, from all over the world. Now, last year, this event attracted 5,000 visitors with an economic impact of £403,000. And I warmly extend an invitation to the Cabinet Secretary and any other interested members to Bonfest this year, which takes place from 28th to the 30th of April. But Angus LEADER in particular is looking at other innovative ways of working, including with Angus Council's crowdfunder platform. This is the first of its kind anywhere in the UK, and the brainchild of Business Manager for Funding, Policy and Projects at Angus Council, Shelley Haig. This crowdfunder project was nationally recognised with a Gold Award at last year's COSLA Awards, and further recognised at a UK level, gaining a nomination at the Guardian Public Service Awards in London. There have been 15 projects which have so far levered in over £400,000. LEADER is looking at ways in which it can work hand in hand with participatory budgeting and wider community empowerment to truly transform our rural communities. For that work to continue and projects like this, we need to know that funding is in place for that to happen and the policies behind it need to be right. And if the nature of the policy or funding is to change, those involved in all those different sectors I've mentioned today need to be involved. The farmers, the fishermen, those who help to design and deliver these rural development projects on the ground. We need to retain and protect specific financial support that is vital to those pillars of our rural community I've outlined today. And I'm proud that we have a government that's continuing to fight Scotland's corner on this and who will continue to try and get the best deal for our farmers, our fishermen and all of those in our rural communities.
We now move to the closing speeches and time is very tight, so no more than 6 minutes, please, Mr. Rumbles.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's been a very good debate. The 9 contributions that have been in the open debate, particularly, if I just concentrate, I think I'd like to respond to some of these. It started off a little bit rockily, I have to say, with first Emma Harper and then, well, Emma Harper attacked the UK government, Finlay Carson attacked the Scottish government, and I thought we were going to go down that route, and I'm glad to say we didn't. If I could just gently say to both Emma Harper and Gail Ross, it would be very helpful if members could take interventions because it actually creates a better debate. Otherwise, we just get a series of statements from people. And I think it would really be helpful if people did that. Gail Ross, I thought was very important when she mentioned 35% of funding for the University of the Highlands and Islands come from the EU, and she said it's not a gripe, it's a reality, and there are real issues about this. Claudia Beamish talked about that she wanted to focus on the opportunities any new system gave for aiding our environment, and that's a legitimate, entirely legitimate approach to take. I have to say, Stuart Stevenson, I do like Stuart's contributions as well as many other members I know, but I do think he was rather unfair to Peter Chapman. I even was about to intervene on him at the point because I thought, well, you know, as important as Peter Chapman is to this Parliament, I don't think it's fair to Peter to hold him responsible, personally responsible, for guaranteeing that the UK government will deliver 16.4% of the share of the subsidy that we normally get. So I thought it was a little hard on Peter. On Edward Mountain, of course.
Yes.
Peter Chapman.
Say that I am very grateful for Mike Rumble's support for my position.
Mike Northeastern, as you say, stick together. There we are. Edward Mountain, I thought, would give a very good speech, and after asking people to take interventions, refused one from Stuart Stevenson, but he did come back. He did come back and take another one. He talked about mountains. Edward Mountain talked about mountains, butter, cheese, etc., and pointed out that the past wasn't always as rosy, and it's an important point that he made. And he talked about all stakeholders needing to get together, and that was the very point I'm trying to make in the amendment that I'm putting forward tonight. And I hope the Conservatives will feel that they will be able to support it. Willie Coffey pointed out that he talked again about the 16% of the UK cap payments, but under Bonnet, we might only get 8%, and that is a legitimate and a very important point to iron out. Mark Ruskell talked about the importance of the Scottish Land Commission, and Vary Evans was a very good contribution as well, although I have to say I'm not au fait with really her identification of that down at Kirriemuir. Can I just say that I think this debate is already about, to some extent, about, you know, we receive more in funds or do we receive less in funds than we currently receive in cap payments? Well, I really do believe that this is obviously important. I do actually think it's putting the cart before the horse. I certainly believe, and we believe in the Liberal Democrats, that it's absolutely essential that we focus on getting the agreed principles of any future monies right, so that the Scottish Government can allocate them when it gets those funds through, and however, whatever level it comes through at, appropriately and properly. If we don't, if we just talk about whether the money's enough or it's not enough, or we plead special cases, if we don't all come together from right across this chamber for the good of the Scottish rural economy and agree the principles on which this funding will be delivered, we're going to get it wrong and we're going to cause real divisions out there in the rural economy. So I really do genuinely feel that it's important to get the principles right. Otherwise, people will defend their own patch. I'm not going to take the whole of my allocation because I know time is short, but those are the points that I wanted to make. Thank you.
Much appreciated, Mr. Rumbles. Thank you. I call Rhoda Grant up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm glad we had this debate because time's tight and many of those decisions need to be made sooner rather than later to give comfort and security to our rural communities. And I'm a little disappointed that members can't unite tonight around certainly my own and Mike Rumble's amendment, because I think it sets a more positive tone and I'd urge Conservative colleagues maybe to reconsider that. However, I think what we are united around is that we need to support our rural communities going forward, farming, fishing, and also the many other activities that members talked about that need support to make sure that our rural communities thrive. Fergus Ewing opened the debate and he rehearsed some of the challenges, which again, some of his members did as well. And we are very aware of the challenges, but that, in our mind, means that there is a greater need for closer working and to try and put our differences aside and work for the good of our communities. We know that the movement of labour will cause challenges to farms. We hear about a point system that won't work for low-skilled migrant farm workers. And while we need to protect their working conditions, which are often poor, we also need to make sure that they're able to continue because our farming community is dependent on them as they are as of the work that they do in Scotland and indeed the rest of the UK and Europe. We also need access to the single market. It's really important for our farmers and producers that that happens. I was interested to hear about the TATI and indeed with the exchange between Fergus Young and Stuart Stevenson, I could see a Save the Scottish TATI campaign starting. But hopefully it won't come to that, and I maybe make that comment a bit too flippantly, because it's really important that we protect those suppliers that have markets beyond Scotland and the UK and make sure that they, not only for the benefit, and I think this is where we have to sell this to the rest of the EU, because it's not only us that benefit from that trade, they also benefit from receiving our high quality produce. Financial support was also mentioned. Gail Ross talked about UHI and others talked about financial support for farming and fishing and indeed rural communities. I think it's important that we reiterate the need for that support. Fergus Ewing talked about agreeing with us on repatriating powers, and that was very welcome. And I think, to be honest, most people in this Parliament will agree to that. But he also talked about how we then distribute funding for farming and rural communities throughout the UK. And I think I made clear in my speech that we need a much fairer distribution because our geographical disadvantage compared to the rest of the UK. We would not be again having a level playing field across the UK where farmers receive similar amounts and maybe even fight for a bit more because our disadvantage is greater. But at the same time, that will require us working with the UK government very closely and maybe ceding some power. So we need to be careful what we're asking for and how we go about achieving those aims. And those are things that we need wider discussions on. Peter Chapman used his speech to talk about the horrendous issues with CAP, and I think everybody agrees that that has been a huge problem for our rural communities. But maybe this wasn't the time for it. I think we'll have those debates again, and I'm sad to say I think there will probably be more problems than that than has already been before it's solved. And I think we can discuss those and indeed hold the government to account on that at that time. He also talked about red tape, and he's right, but we also have to remember that a lot of that red tape didn't come from the EU, it came from our own government's gold-plating domestic policy. Mike Rumbold's amendment, which we have said we will support, I think is good, and he talked about how wide that commission had been. Talked about the work of the NFUS, which we totally agree. I mean, their briefings are coming in, I was going to say daily, but more often than that. And they've already started thinking about those things. They need to be involved, as do the NGOs, as do the Fishermen's Federation, consumers and producers. And that's why I would have a slight disagreement with Mike Ruskell, because he talked about the Land Commission doing this. I think the Land Commission have enough to do to deal with things like farm prices that he spoke to in the debate. I think we have land ownership in Scotland is way wrong. We need to focus on that, and the Land Commission's job needs to be doing that, while we need another commission to look at the way forward and with a wider base of stakeholders. Claudia Beamish, my colleague, rightly talked about all the environmental issues, and I was depending on her doing that because I only touched on them, about farming, about organic farming, forestry, and indeed co-ops, and how Pillar 2 funding helps co-ops and community groups, and from brewers to chocolatiers and the like, and indeed leader funding, which is so important to many of our communities. Presiding Officer, I hope this debate has sent a clear message to colleagues in the UK Parliament. We need to be part of future negotiations on trade deals and the parameters these will set for our food producers and rural communities. We need to be clear that new structures don't cause further poverty to either producers or consumers. And while we do recognise the challenges going forward, we also need to make the best of it in order to protect those we represent.
I call Maurice Golden. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This has been an engaging debate with some interesting contributions. Fergus Ewing started things off speaking about some fruitful cross-party discussions, not with ourselves, but with other parties. He also then followed that up with a New Year's resolution to work across the chamber, and I feel it's appropriate to point out that just 8% of people successfully achieve their resolutions. I do look forward to seeing the Cabinet Secretary at Bonfest, however, as suggested in a slightly bizarre contribution from Mary Evans. Moreover, the Cabinet Secretary then spoke about a repatriation of powers and indulged in some quantum theorising over possible futures, a point also made by Emma Harper. But let's look at what the UK Secretary for the Environment said. It is vital that we start planning now for life beyond 2020 and that the UK government was committed to supporting British farming in the short and long term. We welcome these words and recognise that leaving the EU presents us with the opportunity to design a rural development system that is fit for purpose and will cut red tape and bureaucracy. And we would prefer to work with the UK government to ensure that we have a system that not only works for Scotland, but one that works better for Scotland than the current system. Rhoda Grant made some interesting points, particularly around food production and food poverty. But particularly on the amendment, I would firstly think it's important to point out and note that the Scotland Act of 1998 was drafted while we were a member of the EU, and therefore devolving further powers in line with the Scotland Act is misleading. Secondly, the priority should be on getting the best deal for the UK, getting powers repatriated, and then we can consult on what powers should go where. Stakeholders like the NFUS are not clear as to what powers should be devolved, and squabbling between devolved administration and Westminster will just distract from the important job of getting the best deal for the whole of the UK. Yes?
Stuart Stevenson.
I express no dissatisfaction that the UK gets a good deal. Let me say that straight away. But I do encourage the member to consider whether, in seeking a deal of a particular character, there is intrinsic value in that reflecting particular needs of Scotland, for that matter, Wales and Northern Ireland as well. So therefore, it's not just about listening by the UK government to the devolved administrations, it's about acting on concerns that may be brought forward. Perhaps privately, by the way, we may not hear about it, but genuinely changing what's being done, not waiting until the deal's done, but making sure there's a contribution to the deal from the devolved administrations.
Maurice Golden.
I agree with the member that we have to recognise concerns, and I believe that the UK government will do that in a positive manner. I like Mike Rumbold's amendment to establish an independent stakeholder group to provide more certainty across the sector, and his contribution highlighting a more simplified system was also welcome. Gail Ross spoke about the impact of EU funding in her constituency, and I recognise those concerns, but it's also worthwhile noting that the UK contributes tens of billions of pounds a year to the EU, yet only receives, yet around about 8 billion doesn't come back. We also had mention of unwanted mountains, although I'm not referring to my colleague Edward. And Mark Ruskell, I thought, made a thoughtful contribution, but new agency powers for the Scottish Land Commission is something that we would struggle and find it very difficult to support. But I want to focus the majority of my remarks today on the opportunity that regenerative agriculture presents for Scotland. But before that, it has to be pointed out that it is disappointing that we stand here again debating Brexit. No longer are the SNP content with Brexit Tuesdays, but they are now shoehorning it into other debates as well. I think that the focus of the SNP government should be on matters important to the people of Scotland within the competence of this Parliament. That's why I welcome the contribution of both Peter Chapman and Finlay Carson, who highlighted the cap payments fiasco, a situation which is now not fully resolved. Claudia Beamish spoke passionately about organic farming, and I agree with much of what the member said, but would go one step further. Certainly with regenerative agriculture, it offers many opportunities for Scottish farmers and can broadly be defined as a combination of practices, including permaculture, organic, no-till, holistic grazing, and keyline land preparation. It will help to shift towards an agricultural model that helps the environment by improving the soil and encouraging biodiversity. This transition would also see economic benefits based on the reduction in fertiliser and pesticides, alongside an overall reduction in agricultural-related greenhouse gas emissions. I should point out that these regenerative practices won't fit the business model of every farm, but they should be encouraged. Some benefits of this practice include the removal of greenhouse gas emissions by acting as a carbon sink, decreased water usage, and giving farmers better control over their cost base as inputs needed for a farm are generated by the farm itself. So what do we need to do to embrace this change? Well, we must educate farmers that are not familiar with these practices and may be risk averse or resistant towards them by making a strong business case. We must develop new skills. We must heighten consumer awareness. And a great example of these practices is the 4% or 4 per 1,000 initiative driven by the French government. This Parliament must show the vision for our agricultural sector and look to maximise innovative opportunities going forward. I urge the Chamber to support the amendment to the motion in the name of Peter Chapman.
I call on Fergus Ewing to close this debate. Up to 5 o'clock, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I thoroughly enjoyed this debate, and I was delighted to receive an invitation from Mary Evans to the Bonfest, something about which I must confess to have previously been ignorant about, but after her contribution, I now understand that it showcases popular music, Presiding Officer, in the post-Frank Sinatra era. The debate itself raised a great many contributions, and I thank all members. I want to briefly reply to some points and then move on. I'm sorry I can't reply to all, but if members really wish me to reply to any points, please do let me know, and I will work with them as per my New Year resolution. Mr. Chapman pointed out the delays in cap payments. We'll discuss this on the Rural Committee next week under the chairmanship of Mr. Mountain, and this is the top priority for me and remains that to resolve. I undertake that to members. It uses up quite correctly an enormous amount of time and effort, and I'm pleased, of course, that we have had some success of payments at 99.9% payments by value by 15th of October in respect of the Pillar 1 payments. And also the loan scheme, which has injected £267 million into the rural economy, and which I think has been appreciated by farmers. But that is not enough. I will not be satisfied, as I've said before, until the whole system is back on track. And I thought it sensible to start off by repeating that undertaking, Presiding Officer. I agreed with much that Rhoda Grant said about the importance of protecting rural communities, and especially in the Highlands and Islands, which she represents. I thought Mr. Rumbles made a very positive contribution, and in relation to the setting up of the group, I was pleased to have had discussions prior to this debate with the Liberal Democrats, which were fruitful. We need to continue that close engagement with stakeholders, consider all the options, and we will therefore heed the call made in the Lib Dem amendment, which we will support tonight, to establish an independent group, and we will support the Labour amendment tonight. And I do hope, as Mr. Rumbles, I think, exhorted our colleagues in the Conservative benches, that we could reach a unanimous agreement tonight, but we shall see. It's clear, Presiding Officer, that public funding for rural development is critical. We all agree in this debate that it drives forward our rural economy and that it protects and enhances our natural environment. We had excellent examples from Gail Ross about Erasmus, from Stuart Stevenson, Mary Evans, and Mark Ruskell about LEADER, from Claudia Beamish about the contribution towards organics and soil improvement. I thought all these points were very well made, but we went wider than that, and Mr. Coffey made the point about the contribution the EU makes to broadband and connectivity, which is so important now and another extremely pressing matter for me. And many members, including Mary Evans, made the point about contribution to society beyond agriculture. And I think, to be fair, I think it was Mr. Chapman of Mountain said that, yes, that was something that we acknowledged too. So, I mean, I think there is a consonance of objectives, but there remain serious doubts about the funding. And whereas Mr. Rumbles is correct, that I do think we need to marshal, if you like, a set of principles around which we can coalesce, I think we also do need to have clarity about future of funding. I think both go hand in hand. I don't think we can go for one or the other. I do think that both is required. And, you know, in my defence and in defence of the Scottish Government, I would point out that the vision for Scottish agriculture, which was launched by my predecessor, Richard Lockhead, went a long way, I think, to set out those principles. So, in accordance with my New Year resolution, I undertake to write to the spokesman with a copy of that document, which I think does set out very useful principles. And that might then be the basis for further discussions with party spokespeople, which I'm more than happy to have to discuss these important matters in the spirit of cooperation, which I have suggested. So there is a consonance of objectives. And I think we have been concentrating on pursuing opportunities, Presiding Officer. Perhaps there was a suggestion, perhaps it was slightly churlish, I felt that we weren't pursuing these, but I can assure all members that it has been an absolute determination on my part to grasp all opportunities available in rural Scotland. That's why, Presiding Officer, I and various of my colleagues, including Mr. Russell, Ms. Cunningham, Mr. Stewart, have led summits, meetings, bringing together people on timber in the south of Scotland, on timber in the north of Scotland, on shellfish, on aquaculture, this Monday on food and farming and agriculture, Ms. Cunningham, with the NGOs in respect of the environment, myself in respect of rural development with rural development parties, very shortly in respect of food and drink and manufacturing. And the whole purpose of this activity is to galvanise effort to ensure that we grasp opportunities in rural development and working with all stakeholders. So I'm happy to work with all members and grab all opportunities that are available to us. But the concerns in this debate are, I think, threefold. One, future funding. Two, access to markets. And three, immigration and labour policy. And I think it is absolutely correct that we pursue, first of all, the unresolved matters, the unresolved issues, prior to, if you like, clearing the way for the negotiations with the UK regarding the future of funding to replace CAP. And those three issues, and I identified them, are convergence funding, the sea fish levy, and the red meat levy. And the UK government, to be fair to them, acknowledged that these issues exist and they require to be resolved. Now, I was said that I should get round the table with Ms. Leadsom and Mr. Eustace. I've already been round the table with them. The trouble is, sadly, there wasn't really very much on the table. However, I am meeting with them next Thursday, the day after Burns Night, and I will be pleased to discuss this again with Andrea Leadsom and Mr. Eustace, and we will be putting proposals on the table for discussion, setting out some of the principles, describing some of the circumstances which we apply. However, I think in conclusion, Presiding Officer, the key issue is this. What will replace the funding from the EU upon which our rural community has depended and has thrived in many ways over the past decades? Contributions that we've heard of from throughout this chamber, from members across each party, including the Conservatives. What will replace that funding? Well, Mr. Eustace, with whom I have a workmanlike relationship, was very clear when he said on 26th of May this year that leaving the European Union would pay an $18 billion a year Brexit dividend, which would allow the UK to spend $2 billion on farming and the environment. George Eustace before the referendum. And secondly, he said, the truth of the matter is this. If we left the EU, there would be an $18 billion dividend, so could we find the money to spend $2 billion a year on farming and the environment? Of course he could. Would we, without a shadow of a doubt? Now, I think we should hold him to that pledge and promise, Presiding Officer, and next Thursday, when representing the Scottish Government, I meet him. I hope that I will be able to say that I've enjoyed the support working cross-party with colleagues in the Labour Party, the Green Party, and the Liberal Democrats. And it's never too late for the Scottish Conservatives, Presiding Officer, to come on board.
Thank you. That concludes our debate on the future of funding for rural development. There are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. And I would remind members that if the amendment in the name of Peter Chapman is agreed, then the amendment in the name of Rhoda Grant falls. The first question is that amendment 3463.3 in the name of Peter Chapman, which seeks to amend motion 3463 in the name of Fergus Ewing on the future of funding for rural development be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on the amendment in the name of Peter Chapman is yes 30, no 88. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that amendment 3463.1 in the name of Rhoda Grant, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Fergus Ewing, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on the amendment in the name of Rhoda Grant is yes 88, no 0. There were 31 abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. And the next question is that amendment 3463.2 in the name of Mike Rumbles, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Fergus Ewing, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. Someone did say no, but the result of the vote... The result of the vote on the amendment in the name of Mike Rumbles is yes, 119, no, 0, abstain, 0. The amendment is therefore agreed. The final question is that motion 3463 in the name of Fergus Ewing, as amended, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote. And members may cast their votes now. Thank you. The result of the vote on motion 3463 in the name of Fergus Ewing as amended is yes 88, no 31. There were no abstentions and the motion as amended is therefore agreed. And that concludes... point of order, Julian Martin first.
Officer, a point of order under Standing Orders Rule 1.6. This afternoon, during the questions to the Cabinet Secretary of Environment, Climate Change and Rural Affairs, Alexander Burnett asked a question relating to government grants available for house builders. He did not declare that he is a director and chairman of a house building company, which is the North Bankery Company, which has significant interest in house building in the northeast of Scotland. Given that this is yet another instance of Mr. Burnett consistently using this chamber to deal with issues of importance to him personally, an issue which you may have seen in the Sunday Post last week, can the presiding officer remind him that if he is asking those kind of self-serving questions, that he obeys Parliament's rules so that his constituents at least are made aware of the fact that he's doing so and then can draw their own conclusions?
Can I thank Julian Martin for alerting me that she was going to raise a point of order. In this case, it's up to all members to make a judgment as to whether to declare their interests or not. Christina McKelvey.
Presiding Officer, forgive me for not alerting you earlier to this, but earlier today, Ruth Davison used First Minister's questions to raise an individual business rates case on behalf of the SCORE Group. It is my understanding that this company and its chairman have given considerable support to a number of political causes close to Ruth Davidson's heart, including Better Together and Scotland in Union. Can the presiding officer give members some guidance on whether it is appropriate for Ruth Davidson to use the weekly opportunity to hold the First Minister to account in advancing the cause of her Tory cronies and, crucially, presiding officer, not declaring any interest.
The political allegiance or otherwise of any organisation is certainly not a matter for me to rule on. That's not a point of order. Can I suggest that closes decision time? I close this session of Parliament.